Good morning, everybody. Welcome. I am excited to be here. If I haven't met you, my name is Jeremy, and I have been away on sabbatical for the last 3 months. It's been a pretty significant time. I will talk more about it in the weeks ahead. But today, I just want to say I'm excited to be back. Really excited to be back. The last 3 months have had significant space for me and the Lord. For me and my wife and my children, we've had the opportunity to be, I've had the opportunity to be in 17 different churches, 5 in Romania, about 8 in Canada, 2 in the United States, and been able to just gain a greater picture and encouragement. I just want to encourage you with these words. The movement of Jesus is alive and well. Did you know that? Amen. And, you know, we hear on the news and we read statistics, but you know, we had the opportunity to be in room after room after room after room with hundreds of people worshiping Jesus, the Word of God being preached faithfully, people celebrating, fellowshipping, going out on mission, my heart was filled. My heart was filled with joy in that, with the vastness of what God is up to in this world. Honestly, my heart also in those times, and Sabbath does these things, it takes you out of, like, who's making the PowerPoint this week, to some of the bigger things in life. And so my heart also was burdened in a fresh way for the lost. You know, we live in a region where 90% of people in our Edmonton region haven't gone to church in the last 3 months. There's work to do. There's people who are living in sorts of ways in their life, in a variety of ways, without the hope that Jesus Christ offers. And in all of that, my heart returns to the church. What are we to do about it? And this opportunity that we have to be people together who pursue abundant life and invite others into it. So a huge part of what I'm doing today, really the only thing I'm doing today as quickly as possible, because you came for the hot dogs, is actually I talked to one person who doesn't like hot dogs and came anyway. So good for you if you don't like hot dogs. Congratulations. But really what I want to do today is briefly lay out the theme and the direction for the year ahead. But I really, really want to say I'm so thankful for the time away, so thankful for the staff and the various ways that staff and leaders have led so well over the last number of months, and really, really excited to dig back in. So more on that later. I have one big announcement before I jump into the theme that I want to make, and this is a big deal for our Connors Hill site. Hello, Connors Hill. Hello, Sherwood Park. But it's a big deal for our whole church. And that is that last January, Corey Seibel let us know that he was transitioning away as the Connors Hill site pastor. I am here, and I'm excited to announce that we do have a recommendation for the Connors Hill site pastor. And next week, we're going to be hearing from Thomas Belchior. Thomas and Catherine will be here at the church next week. There's lots you can read about them. We believe that God has led us to recommend Thomas for this position. So next week he'll be preaching at Connors Hill. There will be a meet and greet following. Everybody's welcome, but especially if you're from Connors Hill, please be a part of that. Please RSVP. There's an email coming out at noon today with all kinds of information about Thomas and next weekend. If you're not on our church email list, you won't know anything. You know, so sign up for the email list. And please, 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 the biggest thing we ask is that you would be praying for this process. And there's an affirmation vote that will happen as a part of this process, too. So praise the Lord as he continues to provide. So I want to jump in a few moments into just opening up where we are going, where we feel the Lord has led us for the year ahead. And, you know, last year, if you were a part of our church family, we looked at the hope we have, the hope of the people of God for eternity. And if we were flying a plane all last year looking at all these beautiful truths of all that is promised for us in the Word of God, this year, all year, we are landing that plane. Because I want to tell you, God has hope for your eternity through Jesus Christ. But God desires for your thriving and your abundance in your actual life today. And that's what we're going to be talking about. And so I want to ask you, would you describe yourself as thriving? Would you describe yourself as thriving? And I want to ask you a secondary question that will undergird our entire set of talks and scriptures this year. How is your life set up? How is your life ordered? How have you arranged and designed your life? And if you are not thriving and your life is not intentionally set up for for connection with the things of God, then the question for this whole year and for today in particular is, would you consider rejigging your life? Would you consider actually setting it up in a different way? I like when things are set up well, because when things are set up well, they are fun to use. Are any of you like me? Now, I have a lot of things in my life that are not set up well. If you saw my file system and you are in the least administratively reclined, you wouldn't be able to sleep for weeks. You would struggle with that. But I like things set up well. In my current house, we got this fridge that we put downstairs. And this fridge is important for life. It's an extra fridge. It has pop, bubbly, and then has a little freezer with ice cream. I encourage this. $50 on Facebook Marketplace. You should get a second fridge. It's just a great idea. But when we brought this into our house, which we moved into a couple years ago, we put it in our utility room right behind the door. There's a little nook. But now every time that I want to grab a bubbly, I have to walk into the utility room. I have to shut the door behind me. I have to open the door of the fridge the other way. I have to grab the thing. I have to shut the fridge. I have to open the door. I have to walk out. This is not set up for thriving. It's not. So while I was on summer break, somebody gave us one of these stand-up deep freezes. By the way, I'm just not a sales pitch this morning, but there is a big new trail appliances being built on the White Mud. And that gave me the opportunity to move, to rearrange, and to move my fridge. And so now I arrange it, and it's amazing because I walk into my utility room and I open my door, and I can keep my door open because now beside my door I can open my fridge and grab a fudgesicle, and I'm off to the races. This is funny, but there are truths in our spiritual lives in this. That so often we keep bumping up into the same thing. We keep coming to the same place, and we go, that's not working quite right. This part of my life is just not, you know, it's not digging too well. But we won't change the things that need to change. We won't move the fridge. We're just going to keep doing it in the difficult way. And, you know, over time, things will happen. Question today is, would you move your basement fridge? And I want to jump quickly through four big truths about how thriving works from Psalm 1. We're going to dig so much deeper into all these wells this year. But I want to give the flyover, four big truths on thriving. Number one, thriving is an available option for your life, but not through direct effort. Just come with me for a moment here. It's available, but not through direct effort. Another way to say this, the Lord has set up the world, and He desires that your life would thrive. Listen to the first verse of the first psalm. Blessed is the one. The beginning of the psalm says, there's a way of blessing. And blessing in Scripture is when everything is flourishing and everything is thriving and the river is flowing with clear water and the fruit on the trees is thick and sweet and juicy. Blessed is the one. This is the start of it. God desires abundance. John 10, Jesus says, I've come that they may have life and have it to the full. Not just later, but now. John 15, Jesus says, remain in me. He says, I told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. Psalm 37, listen to this. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. But it's not through direct effort. And so I want to speak to the lie, if there's anything in you that would say, it's too late for my life, or stuff can't be set up in my life so there would be thriving and abundance. It's just not the truth. It's just not the truth, but it's not through direct effort. Do any of you realize that there are so many things that our society is telling us we have to do more correctly? Do you ever dig into something? Do you ever dig into how many books you're really supposed to read in a year to be, you know, one of the good people? Do you ever try to, like, follow a diet person on Instagram and try to do what they're doing? You ever, you know, say to somebody whose whole life is exercise, how should I exercise? And like any of those things, if you put your whole life into them, you still aren't quite doing them how they should be done. And there's more than 1,000 of these things. I mean, there's like 100,000 of these things that you're supposed to do and I'm supposed to do and we're supposed to learn from the experts and implement it in our lives. Is anybody else tired? Is anybody else anxious? Is anybody else feeling like there's a lot of things? I don't even like tofu, okay? I don't like it. I like the real stuff. But Scripture says, put your effort into God. Put your effort into the one thing. And everything else will flow from that. You can get thriving, but not by direct effort. But if you will put your heart and soul and mind and strength into God, thriving will be a byproduct. This is a claim which you can completely disagree with, but I just want to challenge you, if you're not thriving, have you tried this? And the principle throughout Scripture is agriculture. Listen, as you wake up in the morning and you say, I would like to have a mango. And you open your fridge and there's not a mango. What are you supposed to do? You can't, there's nothing you can do. You can't make a mango. You know, I know on Star Trek you push a button and it's like, mango. But we haven't figured that out yet. But any child, so long as they live like way south of where we live, can plant a seed, care for the soil, pull the weeds, water the plant, at least eat a green bean or an apple or a tomato and, you know, if you're far enough south, a mango. You can't do anything if there's no fruit on your tree, but pay a little more attention to your tree. This is the principle of fruit. And Psalm 1 talks about the way, the path, the setup for our lives. You want to live a fruitful life? You want to live a thriving life? Pay attention to the structure, the way, the order of your life. Would you say you're thriving in life? And how have you set up your life? Is your life chaos? Or is there order and intention and design? Goes into two ways, two root systems. Second big thing here, thriving is hindered through unhealthy counsel, choices, and community. So for these two ways, I want you to imagine yourself like there's roots growing out of the bottom of your life. And I want to ask you just genuinely, like, what are your xylem and phloem sucking up these days? What is going up? What is going up? Because that is the sort of life that's going to be produced. And there's two different options. Unhealthy counsel, choices, and community will hinder your thriving. Would you listen to this? Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers. I try to go walking down White Ave once every 2 years, because I'm old now. But I was there this weekend with some friends walking, and there's a sign on a nightclub, and here's the wisdom offered by this nightclub. Bad decisions make good memories. Counsel is available of all sorts. There's a picture of people dancing with their hands up in the dark light. Woo! This bad decision. Is that your experience, old people? Can you speak to the young people in our room? Is that, you go, man, if I could just get back to a place in my life where I'm making bad decisions, man, those were the days, you know? Those are my best memories. No. No. Bad decisions give you responsibilities that you didn't want for the rest of your life. That's what happens with bad decisions. Oh, round of applause. Okay. It's the old people clapping, young people. Okay, so pay attention to this. And this scripture says, blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked. And the original language is, another way to translate this is in the council. Three questions here. Where do you get your information? What kind of truth are you sucking up into your veins? What are you reading all day, every day? What are you listening to all day, every day? Where do you get your information? Second, how do you make your choices? Stand in the way that sinners take. What is the sort of way? What is the lifestyle? What is the behavior? Where do you get your information? How do you make your choices? Number two. And third, this is so big. Who will you let influence you? Who will you let influence you? You can go the bad decisions make good memories route. But Psalm 1 paints this picture of a tree that has been planted by streams of water. Technically, these words mean irrigation canals. This is not a tree that has got lucky enough to be by a river. This is somebody who has planted a tree and irrigated it intentionally with clean water. What is your tree looking like? Thriving is hindered through unhealthy counsel, choices, and community. But there's another way. Third, thriving is deepened simply through connection with God and His people. Blessed is the one, verse 2, whose delight is in the law of the Lord. Do you believe this? And who meditates on His law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Third, thriving is deepened through connection with God and His people. And there's five things in here. I'll jam through. We'll dig deeper into all of these. First, this delight in the law of the Lord. I love this. Do you delight in the law? What a phrase. Do you delight in the law of the Lord? This is a picture of relationship. I mean, nobody delights that there's words on a piece of paper. But you delight what comes through it, that God is teaching you how the world works. God wants to teach you how to pursue abundance in this life. And when we walk with God in relationship, we open His Word, Psalm 119, over and over and over again. The psalmist says, I love it. I love it. I delight in it. Would you say delight characterizes your relationship with God? Do you ever just feel like the most privileged kid in the world that you get to, my Bible's upside down, that you get to open up your Bible and God says to you in your friendships, in your marriage, with your kids, with your parents, in your school, in your workplace, in your neighborhood, let me tell you how to do that. Let me tell you how to live that so that it's awesome, so that it's thriving. Do you delight in the Word? Second, there's an intentionality, not an accidental approach. You can't control the fruit. You get to the point where there's a rotten tomato on the plant, it's too late, too late. But you can control the roots. You can direct the roots. You can fertilize the soil. You can bring in the water. There's an intentionality. A planted tree by streams of water. Is there an intentionality in your life? Third, there is a beauty in this sort of life. The leaves never wither. This is a tree that people walk up and they say like stuff like this. Nice leaves, you know, of your life. There's a beauty to it. It doesn't mean like, you know, your lips are Botox and your muscles are big or, you know, however you pursue worldly beauty. But have you ever been around somebody whose life is so beautiful? You know, even if their hair is messy or gone, it's like, what a life. There's a beauty to life. Number four. There's a positive impact beyond your life. There is fruit in every season. The production of fruit by a tree is almost entirely not for the tree. Like a couple pieces of fruit fall and fertilize the soil, and that's all very good. But the fruit is for people. The fruit is for animals. The fruit is for the production of more trees. Beautiful picture, positive impact beyond your life. And fifth, and this is so big, and I want to just hit this with a 2x4 all year, this is a life in God that is connected to your entire actual life. This is connected to your life. This is not a call. Someone is not a call for you to stop doing your life and start doing more religious activities. That's not the call. That's religion. That's as opposite to the gospel as sin is opposite to the gospel. That's working your way into God's favor, which you can't do. Instead, there's this connection with your actual life. Listen, who meditates on His law day and night. And meditating, maybe you know in the Old Testament, really what it means literally is murmuring. And so the picture is like you read the Bible and you're getting to know the Bible and God is speaking to your heart. And as you go through the day, you're like, okay, got to get in my car and I got to drive to my thing. You're murmuring the Word. Love your enemies. You know, pray for those who persecute you. You're murmuring it. You get to your office, and you're like, oh, I know what this is about. You get to your school, I know what this is about. You know, you get to that last softball game of fall, or you get to the, you know, the neighborhood barbecue, or you get to your extended family reunion. You're like, love your enemies, you know. Pray for those who, whatever it is. But you're meditating on it. It's not just like, I thought deeply about Scripture this morning. Now on to running my multi-million dollar business on my own. You're taking it with you. And what does it say at the end? Kids, you're rocking. Okay, it's just a couple more minutes. You're kicking it. Whatever they do prospers. God has life for you. God wants you to be great at sports and woodworking and gardening and to be great at having a family and to start an awesome business and just to do whatever you're doing. God desires for you to thrive. Whatever they do prospers. Whatever they do prospers. And so we will talk this year about apprenticing with Jesus in real life. Jesus wants to walk with you. What are you walking into this week? What are you walking into this afternoon? Jesus wants to walk into it with you. You know, the old bracelet, what would Jesus do? I'm pro WWJD bracelets, even though they got a bad rap. But a better question is, what would Jesus do if he was you? Sometimes we read Jesus' word and you're like, okay, so I'm supposed to put on like a man dress, heal people, go stay in the desert for 40 days. No, Jesus wants to teach you how to live your life. You know, I'm a single mom trying to get educated, work a full-time job, find some time to love my kids. Well, Jesus never did that. He didn't. But he'll walk with you in it. He'll walk beside you. He'll be the husband that's not in your home. He'll be the dad that's not in your home. He'll be the business coach. He'll be the education coach. He is the wisest, smartest, most intelligent person, and the funnest person to be around, by the way, in the entire universe. He'll go with you into that. An ailing senior who's losing their senses, losing their driver's license, stuck, can't do the things they used to do. That didn't happen to Jesus, but he'll walk with you into that. He'll show you where there's purpose in that. He'll show you where there's thriving in that. You know, lost my job, got a cancer diagnosis, somebody I love is sick. Jesus walked through some of those things. I don't think he ever lost his job. He'll show you how to walk in that. What about, I'm wildly successful. Everybody loves me. Everything I touch turns to gold. Didn't happen to Jesus, but he'll walk with you in that. How do you steward success? How do you steward when things go well? Thriving is deepened through connection with God and his people. Do you believe it? Number four, this is big. Thriving is worth pursuing both now and forever. And I just want to make this point. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. So both in the results, the day-to-day results, and the ultimate destiny that you are headed towards, the way that you choose to live your life determines how it will go. You can be chaff. You can be chaff blowing in the wind. And have you ever been in a situation where you are completely full of food and you are completely full of entertainment and you still know you are not completely satisfied? You are actually empty on the inside. Your life has become like chaff. But you could be like a rooted, deep, fruitful, flourishing tree. And long term, the way of the wicked leads to destruction, but the Lord watches over the way of the righteous. I am not a tree scientist, but I did read some tree scientists this week. There are three things that make a tree thrive, and I hope I can land this in an encouraging way to whatever you're walking through. Number one, nutrients. Trees need nutrients. Get your roots into good stuff. Second, they need structure. Very interestingly, different root systems, just based on how a tree roots itself, can be better or worse. Structure in your life. And third, stress. Stress. It is trees that actually encounter the wind, encounter struggle, encounter problems in their environment that get the strongest. In fact, interestingly, as a tree is pushed in the seasons of storms, there are small cracks that form, and the tree fills in those cracks and becomes bigger, becomes stronger because of the challenges. And it's pretty hard for us to say to one another while you're walking through challenges and pretty unwise, oh, God's doing that. It's going to be good. I know how this is going to work. It's going to be perfect. Don't worry about it. You know, it's not a good time to give a trite response. But this ends with an encouragement. The Lord watches over the way of the righteous. And really what these words are is this. The Lord knows the way of the righteous. And this word knows is the same word that is used when a man knows his wife. The Lord is so close to you. He's so close to your story. He knows. Not only does he know, but he deeply cares. This is the word used when God saw the Israelites stuck in slavery. He knows, he sees, he cares, he walks with. And he desires to walk along with you in your real life. So landed there. Are you thriving? How have you set up your life? Would you consider a rejig? Would you move the fridge to get Jesus and his people to the middle of all that you do? I want to land with some on-ramps today as we get ready to respond in worship. I just want to throw this out. We'll talk more about all these things. But if you're just going, okay, let's do this, let me just suggest a simple starter structure for your life. And maybe this is all there. Maybe some things need to change. Four things. Number one, daily scripture and prayer. What a great time, the beginning of September, to shift things so that your mornings could start with ingesting a little bit of solid food from the Word of God. It doesn't have to be 10 chapters. Would you read in the morning and ask God to help you carry those words into your day? If you need help with reading plans or any of that, please talk to our staff. Second, committed weekly worship. I don't understand what happened. My friend stopped going to church for 3 years, and then he stopped following Jesus. What are your roots into? Are you willing to find a weekly rhythm where you Sabbath, where you give eternity a day, where you give your destiny a day, where you meet and gather with God's people? Would you commit to that? Third, authentic Christian community. Do you have people in your life? Doesn't have to be 20. Usually it's better with one or two or three. Who at least a couple times a month, you can tell them how you're actually doing. And they can pray for you. Christian brothers and sisters. Do you have that? It's actually not hard to have. It's tricky sometimes to schedule, depending on your life. But do you have that in your life? And fourth, apprenticing with Jesus. Can I just commission you and challenge you? Walk out to the hot dogs. Walk into your Sunday afternoons and evenings. Walk into your Mondays and your Tuesdays and your Wednesdays, trying to actively stay in that place of connection with God. God, what are you saying to me? What opportunities are you putting in front of me? This is a difficult thing. What should I say? What should I do? Invite Jesus into your actual life. We're going to talk this week about how to thrive. Next week, we will jump into John 21. It's good to be back. I love y'all, and we're going to dig in this year. I trust that's for the Lord. Would you stand? And I'm gonna pray as we jump into this. Jesus, we love you. You have invited us into a different way. A way of dependence. A way of reliance. Father, we repent together with all who are willing in this room, in Connors Hill and Sherwood Park, of being self-reliant people. People who are just trying to figure it out on our own, to arm wrestle it down, to do it by our strength and our intellect and our resources. God, all the resources in the entire universe are at your disposal. And you say you will walk with us as friends and you will respond with yeses to our requests. God, may it be that we would walk with you. In the context of Christian community, may it be that we would get our roots deep down into your word and into your life over this year. Would it be that we would actually apply your wisdom in our own life, not just becoming book smart, but getting street smarts in the kingdom, Lord? And would you give us each this deep sense, that you are knowing us, that you are walking with us in our day in and day out. Give us wisdom to order our life for connection with you, Jesus. We want to know you. We want to love you. We want to walk with you. Teach us to thrive, whatever the circumstances. In Jesus' name, amen.